Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may stand against the wiles of the devil.
For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints and for me, that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak.
And I will have Utah.
Sit back and enjoy my style as I shine.
I have loved you from the start. I have seen your hurting heart. You feel so lonely, but you keep on hiding, 'cause you feel so guilty for what you've done.
Later, Zachariah is in Elizabeth's home.
Oh my, what a grip you have.
God made the right choice asking you to raise his son. You are good with children.
Joseph, what are you doing here?
The angel. He visited me as well.
You believe me?
Yes, Mary. Of course I do.
You see, I told you he'd come around. He's a good man.
Oh, I know.
I need to get home to finish our house. But I wanted you to know what had happened. Everything will go forward as planned, if you still want to.
Yes, Joseph, of course I do. I promised to help Elizabeth with the baby for a few more weeks until things calm down.
Well, come home soon. We don't know when my father will send me to get you, but I'd like to be able to find you when he does. After Mary came home from her cousin's house, and after Joseph completed the work on their home, the hour arrived when Joseph's father sent him to get his bride. In jubilation, Joseph and his groomsmen brought Mary out of her family's home, and the marriage ceremony was complete. But Joseph had no union with her. He would wait until after her promised son was born. The child, however, was not born in the home Joseph built, because not long after they wed, the census was decreed, demanding that all people register in their ancestral home. And once more, Mary and Joseph found themselves walking an unexpected path. But they both put their trust in God, knowing it was his path they followed.
Joseph, I can walk a little while longer.
Perhaps you could, but why do it when you don't need to? Let's get moving. All the good rooms are going to be taken.
Turn around and go home! Why do you obey the people who occupy our land by taking part in this census? Rome holds no claim to us. The emperor calls himself a god. But we only serve one god.
Someone needs to explain that to our so-called King Herod. We're almost there. Bethlehem, my ancestral home, birthplace of King David.
And the birthplace of this child as well. We need to get a place to stay, Joseph, and soon.
We'll have a warm bed tonight and connect with my family tomorrow. And they were happy to follow the path together. Jerusalem.
King Herod!
You are General Quirinus's envoy, yes? Welcome. How may I serve you? Governor, Quirinus wants to know how the census fares, King Herod.
General Quirinus is governor of Syria, but make no mistake, King Herod, General Quirinus may not be governor of Judea, but he does govern over you.
Report to General Quirinus that naught has changed since last he sent an envoy to check in on me. People are going to their hometowns as Rome has required, but there are small rebellions and uprisings here and there. His order has used up much of the goodwill I have with these people. The census serves a purpose. It shows who is and who is not loyal to Rome, and I guess to you as well.
The uprisings you refer to give us opportunity to measure what rebellions against Rome from your region might look like. You neglected to report that it is looking like the Pharisees in your region have no plans to take part in the census.
The census is not over. You can tell General Quirinius that all goes well, and you can tell him that he need not send his lapdogs to check on me.
Come. Have you heard the joke Caesar tells about this King Herod?
Sir?
I'd rather be a pig in Herod's house than one of his sons, Caesar says. Herod pretends to be Jewish by not eating pork, hoping the people will embrace him. But he's fed his own family members to his crocodiles because he feared they threatened his throne. He'd have thrown me to the crocodiles were I not an official from Rome. That is a man willing to do anything to keep his throne.
Anything.
Bethlehem, nightfall. Even if I knew where to look for my relatives, I doubt I could find them anytime soon. Let's just find a place to stay for the next few days.
We can find them later. I need to lie down. This isn't what I expected.
Are you okay?
My back is just a little uncomfortable. Let's find an inn.
Please, sir, do you have a room for us?
Does it look like I have a room? I rented out both of them a week ago.
We were hoping you might have a small room available. We'd be willing to share.
Sorry, because the family renting the upstairs isn't willing to share, and I'm already sharing the downstairs with another family myself.
Hello? Please come.
Let's go, Joseph. They aren't going to open the door. From the sounds in there, they've got a full house.
Please, sir. No one has any room for us.
I'm sorry.
We just need a shelter, you see. My wife.
Yeah, you better find a place soon. She looks like she's ready to burst.
Sir, please, my wife and I need a place to stay. We don't need much, just some shelter from the cold.
You should have come earlier.
Yes.
I have no rooms for you, but I have something else. If you are not particular, I can give you shelter for the few days. It's not the best room in Bethlehem, but it'll keep you dry and it's cheap.
Thank you, sir.
Lay down here. Try to get comfortable.
Joseph, we're going to need a midwife.
Yeah, sure. In a couple of days, we'll have found my relatives. I'm sure they'll know of a midwife.
Joseph, you and I aren't going to be able to deliver this baby alone.
Okay, I'll check with my innkeeper tomorrow.
Now!
Oh, abra.
But I shouldn't leave you alone.
There's time, Joseph. It's just starting, I think. Go, but hurry.
Try to cut some time. I'll see if the innkeeper knows of anyone. I'll be right back. Hey, my wife. She's having her baby.
What's going on?
The baby is coming. We need a midwife.
Get back in there with your wife. I'll find one.
They'll be here any moment. Everything will be just fine.
I know.
I found someone.
You're the father?
I'm her husband. You men shouldn't be in here. Take good care of them. That's a very special child.
Yes, yes, we know. You really must go now.
Now, young lady, tell me what you're feeling.
Love incarnate, love divine.
It's okay. You're doing well.
It's too much. I can't.
Here's what I want you to do. Next time you feel pain coming, scholars believe Mary was likely 13 years old when she was pregnant with Jesus. Due to the Jewish traditions surrounding arranged marriages 2,000 years ago. Sir, you have a son. He's beautiful.
Yes, he is.
Hello everyone. We all know when we die, our spirits are set free from our bodies. But did you know that in the same way, when we die, our minds are set free from our brains? You know how there's always somebody who thinks they're the brightest bulb in the room? Well, even anyone on this earth who has a brain is only using at maximum 4% of it. And they might want to convince you otherwise that they're so much smarter. But really, we're all going to be way smarter once we die in and our minds are set free from our brains. We will be able to learn instruments, other languages. We'll be able, math will be easy, capabilities, and things that we couldn't possibly hope to understand now. But when we're in heaven and these things are explained to us, all of this will become so much more clear. Thank the Lord that He's given us His Word in the Bible. Otherwise, we wouldn't have a hope or a prayer of figuring anything out. And for anyone who's still a skeptic, let's look at another Bible prophecy that proves the existence of God.
The fall of Babylon. See, Babylon was one of the richest cities in the world during the years of about 740 to 680 BC. It had walls that were 75 feet thick, they were 300 feet high, and it was surrounded by the Euphrates River that made a moat around it, in some places 65 feet, in other places 250 feet across. And yet, the prophets in the Bible, Jeremiah and Isaiah, they prophesied that God would raise and cause to come up against Babylon an assembly of great nations. Jeremiah recorded that God had declared, "I will dry up her sea and make her springs dry." And the prophet foretold that a drought would come against her waters and they would be dried up, for the land is a land of carved images. And also, the prophet promised that the Lord had spoken, "I will prepare a feast and I will make them drunk, that they may rejoice and sleep a perpetual sleep." Now, interestingly, secular history validates this prophecy. It shows us that the Euphrates River went under the city of Babylon, and yet Cyrus, the king of the Medes and the Persians, redirected the river and caused it to go into a basin, and he marched his troops under the wall of Babylon. And incidentally, the Babylonians were drunk and feasting when that happened. God dried up the waters of Babylon, and they were drunk and slept a perpetual sleep.